in a democracy, the government of the day has a responsibility to create an environment in which all its people, irrespective of race, color, class, creed, sexuality, or disability, is given equal access to education and to participate equally in the creation of the wealth of the nation.
Money at the moment is paid directly from the taxpayer to the teachers, the schools, the buildings and the pupils. Under privatisation, private companies will come in to take a profit from your taxes to deliver those services. Billions will leave state education to run those services.
Over the last few years, schools have really become exam factories. It's about league tables and jumping over your neighbour and competing to get the children who can get the highest results. And what we've seen in lots of academies is that they actually stop teaching certain subjects. So, you know, it's a poor diet for us as teachers, it's a poor diet for you as students.
And this government is sending a message to working class and middle class kids in Britain that actually you ain't got to get an education with critical thinking, you ain't got to get an education that's going to make you think in any way that can challenge the system, but they want factories, production factories to feed into businesses.
Because we're talking about education and, you know, look at things like the literacy rate of the people that are in prison. There's a direct link between education and people that become criminals and take on crime. There's a direct implication between people that haven't got access to education and the people that are homeless or stuck in a state of dependency, can't get a job, the people that sign on and the people that are forced onto training schemes.
You have a great responsibility to do the things that needs to be done to bring about change.
Thank you. Without the 10th of November, we wouldn't have 35 occupations up and down the country. Without the 10th of November, we wouldn't have 130,000 students participating in every day of action that has been called so far. Without the 10th of November, we wouldn't have trade unions, students, school students sitting in this room discussing about the next steps for the movement. Without the 10th of November, I believe we wouldn't be talking about shutting down London on the 9th of December, 1 month after the events at Millbank. And I think that's something explicitly crazy about this situation. But it's not only exciting, because we shouldn't only be cheerleading the movement, we should be talking about a direction for the movement and what kind of a direction we need to be giving to the movement.
I'm a 100% peaceful protester, and I was kind of disappointed with the way that people behaved in Millbank in the first round. And it did raise publicity and it did do some good things, but on the other hand, a lot of people got hurt and it was grotesquely violent. And so I kind of think there's a difference. No, there's a difference between saying that we support the right to protest, which I would 100% support, and are saying that we defend the right to protest legally, because it is wrong to be violent and it is wrong to destroy stuff and hurt people.
Everything you do, do it within the law. I'm not joking, because you would have a lot of sway, a lot of changes that will come about. Those of them who are working outside the law, they're not doing you any good. Because you can argue, you have a great case. You have a great case, use your case to make the changes.
Violence is a very bad thing, but when you take our futures away and fuck off our futures, we'll use violence.
Had the equivalent demo 10 years ago, nobody showed it at all, yeah?
You don't really want to.
And any political change that's ever come in this country, there was a lot more trouble than this. That's the point. Yeah.
The Serious Organised Crime Act makes it an offence to protest within a square kilometre of Parliament without permission. So, in fact, that right has already been removed, and just being there with a placard is an offence. So the idea that you can do it within the law is already false. Just a peaceful protest can already be illegal. I think that it's our duty to look at the law and reject it where it stops us from doing what is right.
Why have we boycott fucking legitimacy? Why have we fucking find a fucking law of our own? It's the police.
We teach our children about how people have rebelled in the past, but as long as it's kind of cosy in the past and no one brings it into the future. I went to a meeting about suffragettes recently and learned that they had a bag especially made that they tied around their waist, and it was made to fit a newspaper that they were selling, the suffragette, and it had a little pocket inside it that was sewed in to put stones in order to break windows. What we need to teach our young people is these are some of the methods that our sisters used in the suffragette movement, and there was nothing wrong with breaking windows then, and I don't think there's anything wrong with that.
I thought passionate protest had died after the poll tax rise. My mature generation considers itself righteous, responsible and well-behaved, but we have dissipated the inheritance of our young and gambled with their security. We can't even nail a banker or corporate tax avoider. I feel hope for the first time in decades. I've thrown away my slippers and I'm ready to join these magnificent young people. It shows how much the student movement has really got to a lot of the tens of thousands of old lefties, the kind of 68 and early 70s generation of which some of us consider ourselves part.
After Day X, the game has changed. We are now in an era of mass movements. It's very interesting that 2 weeks down the line, even Miliband is saying that the Tories are the vandals. That is an example of how we are shaping the political debate.
The government were getting away with the line for month after month on the television. It's a terrible crisis, we're terribly sorry about it. Cuts have to be made, you all accept the cuts have to be made, which ones would you like? That was the dialogue, that was the whole national conversation for month after month. That's gone now. Now the conversation is, does this have to happen at all? Aren't the alternatives? It should be Trident that's cut, it should be the war that's cut, the banks do have the money, and so on, is now mass political dialogue in this country, and the student movement has done that. The first demonstration, the one that was officially called by NUS and UCU, was a huge demonstration which involved some thousands, I'd say 4,000 or 5,000 people within it deciding spontaneously or more or less spontaneously or through the sheer anger of the demonstrators to go for Milburn. The two subsequent ones, I would say, were overwhelmingly school student demonstrators. So they were school students in their majority. They were largely unorganized. When I was down in Trafalgar Square when that one assembled, you know, at any moment, out of some side street or another sort of massive group of school students would arrive with their homemade placards, simply screaming, running into the square, embracing another set of school students, forming a human pyramid on the plinth. Nobody in the square, I believe, actually had a megaphone. Certainly nobody had a PA. When it decided to go down Whitehall, it just decided, like some sort of giant animal, that it was going off, and that was it.
That's what we're here for, free education!
We've like consistently got people down for each demo. Like first demo we got 100 people down, and we got more people down on the other two. And every time, like, people have been shocked by the violence of the police. Like, we've been kettled for hours. Like, the last two times we've been kept there till 10 o'clock in the freezing cold. And the last demo, it was shocking violence, like, with their truncheons. They're talking about bringing in water cannons. But I think a key thing to notice is that it's not really dampening spirits, because people are still more passionate to get on these demonstrations against the cuts, which is going to stop a lot of them going to university.
So the journey on the student protest at my school really started on November the 10th, and the occupation of Millbank definitely inspired so many of my friends at school and other people that we knew. People realised that the fight back had started, and the walkouts were just a great success at my school. We had hundreds of people, we had the younger kids having to climb over the fences and joining us and going on those walkouts. And from there, we decided to occupy, and it was really successful. We occupied the assembly hall. We were locked out by the teachers, the head teacher who found out about it, but we managed to occupy. And our demands were met, which were actually about EMA. We were asking that everyone on EMA still got their EMA if they went to the protest, which was threatened to be taken away. And so that was a great achievement. I think that what the kettling did was really just creating anger at the police. And I've heard lots of arguments from people saying that the student anger against the police is destructive and that we should discourage it. But what I think is, well, we've seen what the police have done to the student protesters, like systematically beating them up and kettling them. And I think it's sort of outrageous to ask students not to be angry with the police. And I also think that there is something real that they've got at, which is that it's the government that are imposing these cuts, and it's the government that are putting the police out on the streets to try and repress us.
And they're talking schools about making active citizens and playing an active role in society. Then you graduate, you get told you can't do anything, go to university, do what you're told. But I'd like to first give a round of applause to the fantastic active citizens from the schools down there. But I think what we need to do now, and I think the poll probably will go through with some little sellout either way, but we need to remember the poll tax, and the poll tax was scrapped a year after it was implemented. And what we've got to do now, the students, the young people have shown the way, the left that have taken this room has got to bring in the next battalions of this war we're doing with the condemned government. And that means in every single borough of this country, reading trade unionists getting petitions with thousands and thousands of local residents on it, making sure that no student suffers in their education or suffers in their life because of things that have taken place in the last few weeks.
A lot of the college students are also facing their EMAs being cut because obviously, you know, where they've walked out in protest to save their education, actually because they missed a lesson, they're having their, the way that they can get to college through their education maintenance allowance and being able to travel and stuff, is then cut off from them. So it is very clearly a tactic that is being used, but you know, by the same groups of people that who are involved in trying to, who are going to eventually have to push through these cuts, right? The head teachers in some schools, the principals, the vice chancellors of universities are the same people who are going to have to push through these cuts, cut down the courses, cut down the courses.
I work as a youth worker providing educational services to some of the most disadvantaged young people in London who have been excluded from school, who have come out from prison, who have been bullied at school. And without EMA, it's very, very difficult for us to keep them in the classroom. So we really need to put this, you know what I mean, it has to be high on the agenda.
Perhaps people have seen the story, I might know it directly from somebody in Oxford, of a 12-year-old who was trying to organise a picket for David Cameron, that the police got him out of school, intimidated him to texting around his mate saying that it was off, took him back to his home, lectured his parents.
For the past 10 years, especially over the war on terror and things like that, we've seen a constant ratcheting up of police powers to repress protests and a constant kind of winding down of civil liberties that, you know, perhaps were once taken for granted. I mean, I think it was about 10 years ago or 10, 11 years ago that we first started seeing the use of kettling tactics. We're seeing the use of mass arrests. This is, again, not just against student demonstrations. I've been involved in demonstrations with the United Against Fascism, against the English Defence Movement, and groups like that. And the tactic of simply mass arresting people and shipping them off somewhere, and possibly releasing some of them, possibly not, is one that's been used for that as well.
You know, the 60s and the 70s, actually, you had mass civil disobedience. You know, people went out and they took on the state and the police, and they were fought back with water cannons, with, you know, batting charges, and that's actually something which has periodically happened in history. Whenever you've got a mass movement on the street that's fighting for justice.
I mean, the reason those young people were kettled was because the police wanted to make those young people think that if you go on a demonstration, we'll keep you thirsty, we'll keep you hungry, we'll make sure that it's really not worth your while to ever go on a protest again. And like, I think this is like the role that the police have actually. And the role they're playing at the moment is that they want to sort of crush these protests using force. So I think we can expect the level of violence to increase, and like the police have basically said so much in all the major sort of national newspapers and things and their press releases. And so I think in London now, and actually like across the UK, what we really need to move towards is sort of teams of stewards who are very well trained, drilled, elected, that can, you know, that can compete actually with the sort of militarisation that the police have, and actually make sure that we all defend, we all stay safe, and you know, we can actually sort of continue to outwit the police like on the next protest that happens.
Keep going.
This movement's been spontaneous. It's not been the case that it's the existing left that has organised the wonderful protests and how they've happened.
And on Tuesday, in our protest in town, we saw the police pretty much change their tactics and try to show the protesters who it was. They tried to cap us at the front, and instead we just split off and surrounded them, and then they were spread across the city. Prison van was pulled out when they were trying to take some prisoners away from the kettle. That prison van was stormed, and people started attacking the drivers and that as well. But what I'm basically getting at is that we've shown these people that we're prepared to go to all measures to really stop them, and that's essential. And that was a process where we showed to ourselves that we've actually got the power. But I think now that we've established that, we've, like, the campaign's matured in many ways. We've still got to have intense direct action, but it's got to be, I think, more strategic in many senses. And we've got to allow for the general public who aren't too comfortable with direct action and who aren't there for a rock with police to be able to come down to events as well. We've got to be able to create that space.
And I think the wider question we have to ask ourselves is actually a question of weight. That was the main point that's why I wanted to get the younger ones involved, because they can't vote. They haven't got any other means of expressing their thing, and when they finally did, they got told, you have to be silent. And I think it's really ironic here that if we start looking at the contradictions, this is like a week on from Children in Need, and everyone's like, you know, the children, and £18 million was raised. But how much did the police operation cost? About what, £20 million? How long were the police officers there? So it was like, yeah, we'll give money for, because you know, they're helpless. But when they actually have a voice, or when they actually have something to say, we'll pay £20 million to shut them up.
A journalist who said, the school students didn't really know what they were there for, and they were only there because they were dropped off by their parents who wanted to relive their student youth. Now, that might have been true for him, but I did say to him, there were 130,000 students on the street. I'm not sure if all of them were dropped off by their parents.
I must have been there last three times. Yeah. Whitehall and this
Whitehall
one. We're planning on going.
Our students have been oppressed. We're the first year to be oppressed.
Yeah, we're the first year. Our year is going to be the first year after paid.
Nick Clegg lied to us. He lied to us.
Yeah.
And these guys, these rude boys, they came up and they were like, nah, fuck this, I'm going to fuck the police up. Don't get in my way, move, man. And I was like, hey guys, let's just all calm down. And I don't think it's quite tactful right now to go in, you know, try to negotiate with them. And they were like, yeah man, she's right. What can I do right now? What can I do on my own right now? There's nothing. I was like, exactly, there's nothing you can do right now on your own, just going to go and fight a police officer. I mean, you have to wait for your time to be, you know, the best time. So just calm down. I mean, there's no way I was going to stop them from fighting, but I could at least leave it for the better time to do it. So I was just like, just calm down, let's all just wait a bit. I'm just saying that my spoken word at that time worked, and I think speaking on the streets to people does actually work, so I just advocate that.
There's a very distinct smell of marijuana around here. Whoever has got any, please share it with me now.
I would be very sort of conservative about their radicalisation. The majority of them went for a fight. That's what they went for. They're saying, yeah, let's get tooled up, let's go. And they want to talk about these things now, whereas I've always wanted to talk about them. Now that these things are going on, they actually tell you, shut up, listen, you know, we've got a radical here, and they like that. And they're attracted to it. But it's a very low level of politics. Most of them, if they read, they read The Sun. But I'm saying, yeah, a lot of middle class people go to university. We want more working class people to go. And more working class men go with this. But it's a big discussion. The discussion's going on, I think. It's through the struggle that they can radicalise. I wouldn't say they're radical now.
Yeah!
They're
going to
try
fuck the police, yeah? Fuck student rights! They're student cuts and shit. You know that? I ain't paying £9,000 to go to uni! Are you mad?
Now, for those of you who don't know, the banlieues are very deprived areas on the outskirts of Paris. And we talk about 68 a lot, but I think there's another parallel here. In what happened in 2005, those you might remember, big disturbances and riots with a lot of young people just very, very angry at their conditions there, and angry in particular at a couple of young boys who got electron music being chased by the police. Now the trouble there is that it was totally unfocused and it turned inwards, and they ended up sort of smashing up their own communities, and they eventually got smashed off the streets by Sarkozy and Gordon Scum. But where I think we have an advantage here is that there's that same level of anger, but the condemned cuts have really driven a focus for a lot of these young people who may not be in higher education, may not be involved in the unions, but are still fucking angry and do want to, you know, smash the fuck out of the police.
That's the beginning of a process. I mean, this has happened so many times in history. You know, when the Leaven was organised, what they called the apron youths, the apprentices of London, who were exactly these kind of kids, kicked off like this in outside the doors of Parliament, forced the MPs to have to leave the House of Parliament by the river because they couldn't get out any other way. So you think about it, if you think that we've got a problem with the sort of starting point, if you like, of, you know, kids in Hackney, think what it's like if you're a Russian peasant. You know, you were starting with a very, very low political culture and they made a revolution.
And what is really clear, I think, is some of the radicalization of the students. Just to come back a bit how it happened. The first, we decided to do a huge EGM. 200 students came out. And we won the debate, a democratic debate, for occupation, I mean from eight votes only. And through the weeks, through the occupation, we had more and more people supporting us. Even yesterday at the EGM, we had the student union guy that stand against us, saying that, I'm sorry, I was wrong, the occupation was a great thing, was very inclusive, and now majority of students are supporting the occupation. And this is a very important move because the radicalization has been going on for 3 weeks. We had people that wasn't into politics saying, I went to see the occupation, I went on the demo, and really, I feel like something is happening.
We shouldn't imagine that actually 30 or 40 universities going into occupation is a minor thing. It's not a minor thing. It's a huge wave of occupation. It's the biggest wave of occupation for a generation in higher education in this country. And it gives the whole movement sort of focuses for organisation. It gives it depth. It gives it the ability to articulate politics over a long period of time to a key group of actors who transmit it to others. It politicises the movement. It gives it a theoretical framework, all of which is as important as the mobilisations on the streets.
I just want to say, it's the first time I've ever, in my entire life, I've been involved in this. In the last 5 days that I've visited the occupation, and it's the most democratic stuff I've ever done in my adult voting life, and see what real democracy is like, because I've seen real democracy. It's happening, the infrastructure is here.
It's right that students are at the vanguard, but we don't just want to sit on our laurels and say we are the vanguard. What's happened in a lot of the occupations is that they are bringing in the wider community.
Sorry, this gentleman's from Hackney Community College. He's doing a meeting tomorrow between 12 and 2. He's already got an occupier from SOAS from UCL. Can't really let him down. Let's see.
I'm suffering a pay freeze. They want to take money off my pension. So actually, it does unite us together. And you know, if we win in fighting against our pay freeze and our pension, then it will link into the student campaign.
We will put trade union observers in the occupation, because if you're going to allow bail thugs in on our students, we'll be there to actually to witness what happens and defend our students in that situation. And if you do use the bailiffs, we will actually walk out and go shut the college down, because we're not prepared to see that happen. Management have backed off.
Actually, I mean, I was panicking at the beginning. We called a meeting between the UCU branch and the student union branch, where they voted in principle to occupy that meeting. It was 150 students. And we shaped that meeting to be student-dominated. And that was the strategy that we came up with before that meeting. And that continued all the way through the end of the occupation, which was last night when we had UCU branch out in the quad, you know, clapping them, giving them encouragement, saying, you know, great job. But all the way through the middle, it was you know, it was one act of UCU support for the occupation after another.
But the critical thing is here, whether or not you can get a nationwide wave of indefinite occupations of a mass character, which go, as only a few have now, for the central registry, the central office functioning of the university sector. And I think that's a debate that we should put forward and say, this is the critical next step. You know, you can back the demonstration off the streets, but it's a whole other thing to try and send the police in to start dragging people out of occupation. That, when UCL briefly tried to close down the whole campus, the staff went absolutely bonkers at the administration saying, you've got to stop this now, call it off now, and within an hour, it was called off.
It's quite incredible, really, that the way in which this good idea, which is that students and workers ought to be, you know, struggling together, and workers actually have a lot more clout in society than students, has turned into a complete fantasy version of reality about what is taking place at the moment and about how we can turn a student movement into something much bigger than just a student movement. A lot of people go on about 1968 and what happened in France in 1968. You know, there's a student struggle sparks off the biggest general strike in European history. And what they get completely wrong about that is the mechanism by which the student struggle sparked off the general strike. Students occupied their universities first, and workers, particularly young workers, thought this was interesting and went along to have a look. And they went to the occupied universities, had their minds completely blown by the experience, and then went back to their factories and struck an occupy. It is not the case that students came out of their occupations, went to the workers, and then somehow this took the general strike. The mechanism that an awful lot of the left thinks should be in place, they've got entirely the wrong way around.
For the 68 comparison, we must be careful. 68 also was a different atmosphere. The student wanted to change the whole society. Although it's very strong, the movement here, this is not the feeling to strengthen the whole society.
The NUS and UCU are organising a massive static candlelit vigil.
It's
a glow stick vigil. They're not actually using naked flames, it's like a fire hazard. So what we've said is that we are going to march from Yulu at noon.
We told the police that we may well have up to 20,000 people with us. I think we should stick to that, I think we should aim for that, and hopefully get more if we can. Basically not going to allow us to rally in Parliament Square because they're claiming that Parliament Square isn't big enough for the amount of people that we've got, and that they can't take off the barriers around the grass. Because it's recovering from all of the real people who used to live on it. So we asked them awkward questions like, can you guarantee that there will be no police force charges? And they said, no, of course not. So we can use that. We'll be able to steward and actually do a march, as opposed to everyone just legging it, which was fun, but a bit erratic.
Let's just start from the beginning and explain what's happened since. The 9th of December, we originally called as a day of action, as an after-school special, actually, and then we found out about the vote. And what happened since we made that decision here is loads and loads of Facebook groups have started up and have thousands and thousands of people in them. Some of them are saying they're meeting at Parliament Square, some of them meet at Trafalgar Square, and all over the place, different times, coming from different areas, with different plans, etc. So which is why we called the emergency London Student Assembly last week and have agreed with the London Region UCU to do a demonstration from Yulun to try to bring as many people from here as one big solid thing. Now that doesn't mean that we're going to be able to get the message out to every single person, so there will still be people meeting up at Trafalgar Square, at Parliament Square. In terms of on the actual dates, the NUS have called for a 1 p.m. Lobby of Parliament. One of the things is that they might say, well, we're doing a legitimate lobby of Parliament to lobby your MPs. If we do anything else, that will prevent people going to lobby their MP. It could be seen as a smear or whatever, so we have to think about what we're doing. I think it's 3:30 is the candlelit glow stick vigil.
The stage that you've got across in Victorian Bank, is that an NUS stage? Yeah. They've actually put a blockade so people can't get to Parliament.
Yeah.
The existing stage has been called by NUS and the UCU. Okay.
UCU National, not UCU London. UCU London are backing our one.
Have we gone to the NUS and the UCU and been like, no, don't have a platform, you're giving the police a reason to block the photo. Put it somewhere else. If you want your candlelight visual, fuck off, do it somewhere else.
Proposal to tell NUS.
The critical difference between us and NUS is NUS feels like it has no option to do something on the day of the vote because of the pressure of the mass movement, whereas we think there's no option but to do something on the day of the vote because we need to defeat higher fees and this is the fight of a generation.
Because the NUS's strategy for the last few years of beer and sandwiches with MPs in Parliament has led to an utter failure, and it is this radical movement which has been built in the last month or so which is really genuinely changing the position of students in this country and what people are talking about in terms of the cuts to education.
A candlelit vigil on embankment is a product of the pressure of what everyone's done, the occupations, the protests and so on and so forth, and that's good, we've forced them to actually do something. It's also an attempt to contain the movement on the day and create a passive, non-confrontational event which doesn't go to Parliament, right? Now that is why the demonstration that Yulu and the London Assembly has called is so important. But I tell you, if people just go in small groups or even in quite big groups, the lesson of what happened in the last couple of weeks is the police will stop them, the police will kettle them because they'll be in too small a group. So what we need to do is to have a massive fuck off demonstration that is well organised and that says we as a collective body, the students, we are going to get to Parliament on the day they're voting to put up our fees.
There is only one place where we want to end up. That is somewhere in the vicinity of Parliament, as close as you can get to it, possibly even inside the damn thing, when the vote takes place, right? That's what has to happen. And the only possible way that this will take place is if there is a very, very large number of people moving with one common purpose in that general direction. Now, there is a staring contest, I think, with the police at this point. If they don't back off, if they try and at the end of the day to block this particular route, to say, oh well, we're not going to do it anymore, suddenly this spirals out of their control. This goes from being an issue about students to being an issue about democracy in this country, to being a major social crisis. So my guess is the police will actually back down on the day, and that by sticking to this route, we'll be able to force them to do that. But that's the critical thing here.
We've seen twice now, routes agreed, massive kettling, collective punishment of demonstrators, historic number of arrests, an attempt to intimidate and take away people's legitimate right to protest from a government that has no legitimacy, a bunch of liars who've got in on the basis of lying to us on their position of fees. If we make this about the right to protest, look at how they're trying to stop us from protesting. It's a way also of bringing in other sections of people, trade union leaders, celebrities and so on, behind our right to protest outside Parliament.
I think we should contact all the people on Facebook who are saying Parliament Square or Trafalgar Square and say, no, change that, come to Yulu. We should demand that we go to Parliament Square and rally there. But once we get to Whitehall, I bet the police will battle us for every single inch down that road, because the police have shown their true colours to us. They will not tolerate democratic dissent in this country or criticism of government policy. We're going to have to be prepared ourselves as an organisation, and that means good stewarding, it means clear leadership, and it means absolute steadfastness in the face of police provocation, and even in this case maybe the question of police violence. And I think that nothing less is going to do on the day. I think that's just what we're faced with right now.
Yeah. All those in favour of a rally in Parliament Square? Okay, anyone against that idea? Okay, that's pretty much unanimous.
We're going to go down this road and we're going to get to Parliament Square. It's going to be Kettle, there's going to be another van set up for us, they're going to take people into smashing up the van. So I think Parliament Square, of course, is the target. But announcing where we're going to go and what route we're going to take is a suicide mission. And we should say, yeah, gather at the ULU, we're going to get to Big Ben somehow, see what happens.
I think we need to discuss what happens if they try to kettle us and block our route. So I think it would be great to draw up a list of targets, potential targets, tax evaders, public institutions, etc. And the list should be too long for the police to have people posted at every place. It should be an extremely long list with a map saying to students, if you swarm a few hundred people, this is the first place, this is the second place, and so on if you go down that street.
The Shut Down London element of it does appear to me, I suppose, plan B if it goes that way. So if we don't get to Parliament Square, that is when a repeat of last week will happen, and that amazing cat and mouse game around London. I don't think it's one or the other, it is probably, and all 99% likely to be all of these things.
With the police, and indeed appear to enjoy those sorts of flashpoints. So that is the question, I think, in some regards for the organisers of the demonstration.
People, I remember standing just before the Treasury got rather gloriously broken into, admiring some of the graffiti on the side of it. My favourite was actually, "This is the Treasury," a huge three-exclamation marks, sort of literal-minded tagging, but then suddenly wondering why someone has sprayed N15 on the side of the thing. Of course, it's a postcode tag, right? It's an N15, it's your gang, right? So what it meant was, there's a whole load, and then you see the news later, all those gangs appearing, oh dear. Now, a lot of this, frankly, let's be close about it, is just racist. You know, if you see someone, if you say student protesters, you think, oh, they're wearing a nice college scarf and little Harry Potter spectacles and they're kind of well-spoken, the rest of it, that's a student protester. And if someone turns up and they don't look like that and they come from Hackney or something, they're not student protesters, they're in a gang. Of course, they probably are actually a student protester. Yeah.
this is something we actually want to see happening that I think much of the left isn't really picking up on. So I think one of the things we need to do is find some way to get into those sixth forms and those colleges, find some way to sort of tap into that really what I think is deep-seated radicalism that is now taking place there.
My daughter, who's 16, phoned me up and said she was going home, she'd been kettled once, she was scared to put out the kettle, but she said, do you know what happened in Parliament? What was the vote in Parliament? So I was quite surprised at this because I thought, well, you know, why does she care? We know what the vote will be in Parliament. We know, we've already decided what Parliament is, but she's going through a learning experience. And I think that's an important thing for us to reflect on.
Across November and December, we saw the country's centre start to move left very quickly, and understandably, the right wing aren't going to be overly thrilled about this. So we shouldn't be overly surprised to see some sort of counterattack, particularly by the right wing media. As many of us have seen from the coverage of this process, the fundamental role of the media is in fact manufacturing consent. And anyone who's ever read the propaganda model by Chomsky will see this particularly clear. And we can see from the reporting, actually, Jody being pulled by his wheelchair to the coverage of Alfie Meadows, that the media is not telling the truth, and we really have to fight back against it. It's been stopping the country from joining us, because if people in this country knew the facts about what was happening to their society, the entire country would be changing overnight. They're going to keep us down, and they're going to continue to fight against us, and we really cannot afford to ignore the media.
After the big demonstration on the 9th, the movement will have entered a new phase. There'll have been the vote, and we'll need to decide where we're going to go next. The people will be saying to themselves, a lot of students will be saying to themselves, is that it? Is it over? And people involved in this movement need to say as soon as possible after the ninth, with one national voice, no, it's not over and this is what we're going to be doing. Yeah. And so I think having a national meeting as soon as possible after the 9th is really important. And yeah, for practical reasons, I think the best thing that we could do is ask people from all the different campuses around the UK, who are going to be in London on the 9th anyway, to stay overnight. Then we meet up and have a national meeting the next day, somewhere in central London, possibly in an occupied space. The sooner we do that, the better politically, and the sooner we do that, the better practically. Everyone's in London on the 9th anyway, and the longer we wait, the fewer occupied spaces there may be for us to meet in.
I don't think anybody can say now that there will definitely be another demonstration like these ones in January. That's not a safe prediction to make. For this reason, really, the people on the demonstrations are highly political and have got a very clear understanding of what's being done for them. And it's not the case that you can simply mobilise students again and again on the street, run them against the state machine, and hope that the next time they'll just come back for more. That's not... as everybody knows, this has been a bloody, you can tell from the atmosphere in the room, for the people who've been involved in this, it's an exhausting experience for activists. It's draining.
Because what could happen is, like the famous saying goes, it goes up like a rocket and down like a stick. But in reality, we need to build on the momentum that we have and inspire and bring them into the streets, the millions of people.
Yeah. Why are we doing it to Vodafone? Vodafone have been let off by the government with a £6 billion tax bill.
We'd like to welcome you to one of something that's a very special spectacle on the British high street these days. It's known as a corporate tax avoider. You may be interested to know the Boots, along with Philip Green and hundreds of our favourite billionaires, are currently dodging £120 billion worth of tax. Now, right, ladies and gentlemen, £120 billion of public money they are stealing from you. What do we get for our non-existent £120 billion? The closure of public libraries, the decimation of the NHS, savage cuts to higher education, to the health service, to welfare, to social housing, to the things that the very fabric of our society depends upon. But it's okay, because Philip Green still manages to move all his money to Monaco. If anyone gathered in Boots today would like to come and share with the audience we are clearly gathering about why they feel the cuts to public sectors will be hurting them, their families and their future, please feel free to come and use our megaphone. It is for the public good. This presentation is brought to you by Big Society Revenue and Customs, here protecting your interests in the face of a government that won't.
You're losing money, guys. Open the doors. I want to buy some 40 quid Clinique soap that gives me eczema.
300 million. But taxable, this is a victimless crime, right? I mean, your kids will be just fine, because really, a degree's a waste of time, and we'll survive when the NHS gets privatised, and the Lib Dems lie. But nobody suspects, because when you think about it, poverty's subjective, and it's all so complicated anyway. But wait a minute. If money's gone to him, that should have gone to us, then why are we getting it? And why are the schools getting shut? And why did VAT go up when corporation tax is going down? Just whose money actually is this? It's yours, and it's the police's, it's the nurses and the teachers, it belongs to all the street cleaners, it's the unemployed, the young and old, it's the guy who sleeps outside the shop every night in the cold. Can't you see? We've been deceived, and it's beyond belief. So Philip Green, you dirty thief, pay your tax or we won't leave!
These are democratic decision making bodies, these student assemblies, where we decide what we should do in campuses, and in schools, and it's whether we want to do a national version of that.
No, I mean, it's a very, very good idea to have a national assembly. It's been proposed in a number of meetings. Obviously, it's got to happen, partly because it does send out a signal that the movement isn't over. I mean, in a way, I don't mind necessarily what it's called, although I veer towards it being called a student assembly and then being open to people in education, workers and so on. I tell you why. Because the students are way ahead of anyone else in the movement at the moment.
I think it's crucial and vital that when we have the planning meeting, that there are workers there. That when we have the National Assembly, that there are workers there. Because let's be fair about it, we might be able to shut down London with a few thousands of students, but we want to be shutting down the entire country.
I think we need to be talking as well about strengthening organisations and networks of sustainable resistance. We all know things like local anti-cuts committees, local council housing resident associations, benefit claimants associations, campaigns to save libraries, all these kinds of things we've got to be looking at as well. It's absolutely essential now that students bring on board the might of the working class.
Next time, if there's a, say it would be the second vote or whatever, there was a day of action, the students in the universities need to picket their lecturers out.
Yeah?
The students need to picket the lecturers out. Stop waiting for solidarity. Get on there and demand it and you'll get them out.
The thing that strikes me is, it's really great to hear some letters in The Guardian and so on saying, look at how great the young people are, and it's still fantastic. But I think for some of us whose student days, like mine, are quite a long time ago now, you can kind of find yourself slipping into, aren't the students great, they're all really radical, with a kind of behind think of, and I'll just let them get on with it. Particularly those of us who aren't actually in education at all.
I'm even a bit nervous about being here because I'm too old to fight and I'm too fat to run away, My activist days are over, but I've been there, don't worry about that.
What we've got to think through is how we get more people to actually go on the demonstration. It's that simple. You're there and you're in and you're talking to them. You're not there, you're not in, and you're just passively admiring them or condemning them, or who cares what you think of them, really. You're not in that structure, you're not in that room with them.
In a few weeks, we've turned the government into an isolated, incoherent minority. They can vote through tuition fees. We will continue to march. We will continue to protest. We will talk to workers, trade unionists, the unemployed, the disabled, the homeless, and we say to all of them, join our movement. It's growing. We're getting stronger. They're getting weaker. We need a general strike to bring this government down.
Part of the problem we face is self-censorship idea. The book that basically said we can't take action because it's unofficial, we'll get into some of the union bureaucracies and so on and so forth. And we've got to break from that. We've got to get ourselves in a position where actually we are saying what the students have done has shown the way for every single one of us.
We had a union meeting this week and we debated a motion on a general strike. It's not something that in my trade union history I've ever debated in my union branch. When I had the same argument a few weeks ago, there was a lot of argument. People saying, well, we're not ready, we've got to prepare, we've got to do lots of groundwork. Actually, we won that motion 13-3.
A lot of people on the left in Britain who have been around for a very long time who understand correctly, theoretically, that workers have more power than students. If there was strike action by any serious group of workers, and in particular if there was general strike action, this would finish the government, in a way and in a timescale that the student movement on its own couldn't dream of achieving. Now, all these are, you know, universal truths commonly acknowledged, but the difficulty is that a universal truth implemented in a particular circumstance can turn out to be wrong. You have to get the mediating link between what's generally true and the actual concrete situation in which you exist at the moment.
2 years ago, we came out on strike in UCU with the MUT. It was a powerful, powerful strike. The morale was brilliant. The demonstration was great. People's morale was up. It meant that it gave us a huge political argument inside our workplaces in order to say, how do we fight education cuts? How do we defend our services? And there's no doubt about it. The demand for a general strike today is one which is common sense. People know that the avenues to democracy are very much closed off to us. That's what the students have shown on the streets, you know, in November and December, and indeed through to January, and indeed, hopefully, throughout this year.
We talk about that the government is not a strong government, it's a weak government, because it's a coalition government. That's true on one level. Of course it's true, because two different political parties have come together, and they have disagreements and friction and so on. But there's one thing that makes them actually quite strong, and that is that they represent the interests of the British capitalist class wholeheartedly, which would be up for the destruction of the welfare state, whether it's very quickly or over a longer period of time, and that is why they're in power, and that is the programme that they're pushing through. The only way that we can really hope to stop that, to defend what we got after the Second World War, to defend the gains which we've won over decades of struggle, is by matching them blow for blow, and the most powerful way that we can do that is a general strike. I think that's something that we should start talking about now, not because everyone will agree with it initially. There's very powerful forces in the upper reach of the trade unions who get against it. What they are talking about is coordinating their already existing economic disputes with the government, one day here, maybe 2 days there, okay. That is not the same as a general strike, which by its very nature takes on a political character, because it raises the question of who runs this country.
I think there's a problem with the way that people pushing this call pose the issue of a general strike. Like, firstly, the idea that this is a fantastic way of exerting pressure on trade union bureaucrats is actually a bit misleading. So if you look at a concrete dispute like the London Underground jobs dispute, where the RMT, you know, in many ways the kind of industrial vanguard of the British labour movement, has just made a massive retreat from fighting job cuts on London Underground. And the idea that the way you put pressure on somebody like Bob Crowe is to say, the thing that's wrong with you, Brother Crowe, is that you don't call for a general strike, actually completely misses the point about the concrete role that he's playing now. And that's also true of Sawatka and the other so-called like fighting left trade union leaders. So I think we should avoid making very windy rhetorical calls for general strikes, which actually serve to let bureaucrats off the hook who don't want to fight now.
If you are serious about the idea that every major union in this country will simultaneously bring workers out on strike, you are talking about a political situation which is one step short of what in the Marxist tradition is called dual power. That is, that the government of the country is divided between the official ruling class and the working class movement and the institutions it has created. There will be a conflict between the state power, which will make anything that's happened in the last few days look like a picnic, as it did in 1926 or in France in 1968.
There's a bit of a problem if we build up an argument around how do we defend our services, how do we defend our education in our workplaces and on our campuses, if we then give people a tool like a general strike, which is, bureaucratically speaking, totally out of reach. But the TUC, the organ which would call a general strike, effectively does not exist in good enough form to call a general strike. The TUC is not going to call a general strike. I don't think it pays us well to make huge calls for general strike, which actually linguistically, and like in terms of the way that ordinary students relate to this, create barriers to entry. I think what we will see is not the coherent argument and very eloquently put as we've heard it today. They will see the same old lefties saying the same old things. So I don't think the language of the general strike is an effective tool for mobilising students. Because if you give people this thing which is actually bureaucratic...
Right, it's not about students, it's about workers, buddy.
Yeah, absolutely, absolutely. But again, the slogan general strike, if we just make the slogan, doesn't actually concretely relate to how you get there. You don't get a general strike by shouting general strike. You get to the grassroots activism in your unions.
Let them go! 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 Let them
Who's got a small dick? Who's got a small dick? Do your job!
Absolutely disgusting. We've just been in for a deputation that we applied for through the proper channels, through the democratic process. We were told that the deputation was refused by the Labour councillors. Every single Labour councillor in that chamber has just sat and refused to vote on the motion to allow us to speak, to use our democratic right to listen. Exactly. Shame, shame, shame. You are supposed to be doing proper consultation. You said you wanted to listen to people's views. You said you wanted to represent your local people. You said you didn't want to make the cuts.
If a good 20 of us decided to go in there, we could make this intervention now. We can occupy it now. Does anybody want to do this now? Because that is the only way. That is the only way and single way that we can make an intervention. Who is willing to do this with me now? Can we go now? Can we go?
Let us in! 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 Let us in!
Let us in! Let us in! Let us in!
Hold the line!
For too long, the village people have been treated like a bunch of morons who will be sitting unaware, and we don't even cognate the fact that we're being screwed systematically by a class of oligarchs, from cultural oligarchs to business oligarchs to political oligarchs. The real message is this: to Green, to the Boots CEO, to the 24 millionaires in cabinet, we will not stand for this any longer.
It's our building, not yours.
Give a shit,
our building.
The argument for socialism you can make in 2 minutes. What do you need to know? That capitalism is an exploitative society driven by profit, that we've got the capacity to run it ourselves, we have to smash the state together. That's it. That's all there is to the argument for socialism. That's not the difficult bit. The difficult bit is how you actually make the next step, and the step after that, and the step after that. And to be able to do that, you have to be ruthlessly honest about what's happening around you.
What do we do? What we have here with this movement, we have a radicalization of the society, of the students, certain sectors of the British society with workers, but what do we do with it? Because what we need is to bring an alternative to the people. I don't want 40,000 people joining the Labour Party, because at the end it's the same. We have to give an alternative to the people. And for the moment, in British society, we don't have it. I think we need a new political party on the left, a strong leftist political party to link the different sectors of society.
When there is a political crisis, we have to have a solution as well. It's not enough just to keep protesting. It's not enough just to keep occupying. We've got to start with that, and I think starting by hating the police is a very good start to your political education in Britain today.
And we hope the young people in the future will neither vote for Labour, Liberal Democrat or Conservative, but mobilise and build an independent force.
We need political representation for the next election. You know, we tried Labour, it fucked up the war. In disgust of Labour, some people thought the Liberals would want that. Quite fucked up in seconds. So maybe there is another alternative that we have to build ourselves. But to have the basis for that, we've got to get some forces actually arrayed, I think, first of all, in the protest movement. You have to have a mass presence of opposition before you can build a mass platform for electoral activity. And we don't have that at the moment. If we call the party now, I'll tell you what we get. The old left assembled in a room arguing with each other, and I can't imagine a worse place to be.
This is a new movement, you know, and if it's a new movement, it is really a new movement. We don't know what this movement is. We can only see at this moment the vague outlines of how the movement might develop, and it continues to surprise you moment by moment. When people see this, they think, Christ, this is a movement. How can we control it? How can we stop it? How can we actually turn it back into an old movement, into what it used to be, or what we're used to? Because they're not really prepared to engage with the movement. And I think that's what you see with many political people, with many of the political groups, is they look continuously back to old forms of struggle. They say, well, there's a poll tax, or there's this, or there's that. Whereas actually, it requires us to think differently, to think creatively, and actually to develop alongside that movement.
It's been like a boxing match. In the blue corner, we've had the complacent, flabby champion that's been in for years and years. In the red corner, we've had the lean, hungry kind of challenger with a glint in the eye. And we're really, really shocked. We're in kind of in our corners at the moment discussing strategy and tactics for the next round. And I think one of the brilliant things about the student movement is it's thrown up new organisations and new ways of organising very, very quickly that faces the direct tactical questions. And one of these has been the student assemblies up and down the country, and the others of those have been the occupations.
And anybody who's been in an occupation will know that they organise a lot of the time using, you know, non-hierarchical organising around consensus. And everybody put their hands up like this, I explained what it was, and suddenly there was a bit of cross-pollination. It wasn't just, you know, come to the occupation and learn, it's take it out and bring these great new ways of organising. Another example is that the president of the branch suddenly sets up a UCLUCU Twitter account because he's seen how magnificently effective it's been, you know, that the UCL student occupation is linking up with UK Uncut and SOAS and all the other occupations to get flash mobs going.
Like, you start off with, you know, a lot of divergent thinking, lots of people expressing loads of different ideas, get a solution which works for everyone, so then you're not going to vote on it at the end, say, like, okay, who likes, you know, if we get, you know, two-thirds majority or something, we're going to go through this as a group, because then one-third obviously doesn't support it and it's just forced to go along with it, or is just excluded. So at first you ask for any blocks, it's like a veto, it's if you think this decision, like, fundamentally contravenes the principles of your group. If that's the case, if like there are people who do block it, and it's really useful to have that say, because it might like uncover something which people might not have thought of automatically. And a standard size is like, if your heart's not completely in the decision, but you're happy for the rest of the group to go ahead with it, everyone feels they've participated in the decision, and also everyone will support it more, like the group generally, like will be, you know, more keen to participate in making this decision happen.
Make sure that everybody says something in the beginning, just to make sure that everyone feels that they can talk and comfortable talking, because the worst thing is people having ideas but not being able to say them. So having an environment where people are happy to contribute.
The constant reaffirmation of common goal, of the goal of the group.
You need everyone to feel like they're all equals with everyone else in the group. Because like consensus can't work if you've got like a multi-class system trying to come to an agreement. If people have inherently different interests, consensus won't work. So you have to have everyone kind of agreeing that they're all equals.
So who leads, how you choose the leader, even if there is no hierarchy, who leads, who gets to choose, who facilitates it?
Yeah.
Do you have more than one facilitator?
Also, who decides when there is a consensus?
Having the kind of ability to vote down a facilitator, say, look, I don't think you're doing too well.
Yeah.
If you find that there's some facilitators that are far better than others, is it useful to then get them to do more facilitating in later ones, or is it better to keep rotating for the sake of non-hierarchy?
Like, while you may have, like, say, one or two facilitators who, you know, facilitating the meeting, essentially the idea is that, like, the group self-facilitates.
Individual versus the group kind of thing. So make sure that people are there to further the group and not to further get the group to do what they want it to do.
Well, not even necessarily what they want to do, but not just go there to get it over with, but actually go there to come to a good conclusion.
A decision is reached, if you came up with the idea, it shouldn't actually have to do with you as a person or your ego.
So it's about like the group owning the decision, is it recognising that?
Trust that everybody's intentions are the same, that nobody has a hidden agenda.
Lots of the meetings that we have, which are like campaign meetings, we know that we've got certain factions in those meetings, and we know that they like, we know that they meet beforehand and come along and stick to a line, and like, that makes it very difficult to do something like consensus decision making. I just feel like if we ever tried to implement something like this for like actual decision making processes that we do on a weekly basis, we'd have blocks constantly.
One issue that immediately came to mind is time.
I guess one reason why people go for majority isn't just for the power of it, but just because, look, we've got a decision, let's go ahead and do it now, like, let's get things done rather than fucking around.
Yeah.
Does everyone want this kind of decision making?
Yeah.
Do people weigh up the time versus the benefits of it?
It's really hard, actually.
Yeah. This is all stuff like you can kind of continue getting better at, like, pretty much infinitely, indefinitely. It's an ideology which is, you know, prevailing in our society, where there's all these conflicting groups which, you know, think that there's this sort of this zero-sum game where, like, one person's benefit can only come, or one group's benefit can only come at another person's harm. Whereas consensus is all about, you know, sort of actually working out, like, no, that's bullshit. Like, there's enough resources in the world to sort of satisfy everyone's needs.
So if we have a general election, we'll either get again what we've got right now, or we will get it to a majority government. So we really need to think about that as a strategy going forward. I think it's much more important to focus on accruing our own strengths and making this thing build and build and build, rather than really talk about having a dissolution of Parliament. I think now that we've got a Tory government, the left is really vibrant again, it's growing, it's powerful, it's really articulating itself. I think we undermine that if we have a Labour government anytime soon. So I think that were we to bring on the government, it's actually going to kind of undermine these really radicalising lines we've got. I think we build, we can profoundly move the centre to the left in this country in the next few years if we keep moving forward.
We're a country that's gone from 50 years ago having 10% of our population in higher education to today having 40% of our population in higher education. And that's not the end game. We want to see, you know, 60 or 100% of our, you know, population at least able to go to higher education. We've seen only our wealth divide get bigger over the last 20 years, and obviously we'd like to get smaller. We want equality. But with our like end games where we're going, we do want to bring down the government. We do want to occupy, you know, schools, but we also want to occupy libraries, town halls, occupy parliament. We want to occupy countries. We want to occupy everything.
Of course, breaking the government is in one way only a beginning as well. And we certainly don't want to perpetuate the cycle of lousy Tory government broken, followed by lousy Labour government broken, followed by lousy coalition government broken. It's a demeaning and demoralising prospect that every generation will have to fight exactly the same battles as the last one. We want a different society. We want a society where these struggles aren't constantly recurring, where we don't have to reclaim the same rights, fight the same battles, fight the same excesses of exploitation, but want an end to it. But the question is, how do you get there again? And if we break this government, that is a very big step on that direction. But for that to move forward, is first of all, there are a larger number of people who are actually convinced that there should be a completely alternative system.